Hello, viewers and listeners. Welcome to yet another episode of the Right Now Show. This is the 8th episode of the first season of our show. And each episode builds so much excitement, brings in so much enthusiasm. And for us itself, for Abhinandan and I, it has been an amazing journey so far. And the more we start speaking to people, the more we start realizing how much there is to learn from everyone and how many amazing stories that there are. So on that note, we have an amazing guest today, yet another amazing guest. So without any further ado, I call upon Abhi to give a proper intro.
Yep. What's up, listeners? So like Abhinav said, we have a very, very exciting guest today. This is the first time I've given an introduction to him. I've obviously spoken to him a lot of times, right? But the person I'm sitting with has spent a majority of his working life at sea. Not that he's a retired or an old man, but he's a young man who dared to dream, challenged the norms of the society, followed his passion, and went on to have a career as a sailor. He's worked at a couple of shipping companies and traveled to various continents in this capacity. We have with us today the Aquaman, Mr. Jeff Narona.
Oh, welcome, man. Mr. Jeff. What are you going to say? Popeye the Sailor Man.
What an intro, Abhi. Thank you, yes, thank you so much. Yeah, as you rightly said, before this, we never did a formal intro. I mean, our intros always were like, "What's up?" Yeah. Or maybe, "Voila," you know, all that shit.
Yes.
So, yeah. Thank you for that. And thank you, both of you, for inviting me to speak on your podcast. Although I was reluctant at first, but then I couldn't say no to Abhi. So, yeah.
Yeah, so this is a forced acquisition.
Yeah, pretty much, yes.
Abhi, you're like Godfather, man. You're making an offer he can't refuse.
Yeah.
Abhi is the Godfather, yeah.
I'm really humbled by all of your words. Yeah. But then I think today, this is something I've always been intrigued about, right? Life at sea. We've never spoken in any of our conversations in terms of how, or in detail in terms of how life is at sea, and then what are your challenges, and what are the lovely stories and experiences you have with it. But I think before we really get to that point, right, we need to understand, and probably the viewers need to understand in terms of how a brief intro in terms of how important shipping is to the world. And then what if one day all of you sailors, right, people who sail, kind of just say, no, we're not going to sail. What happens to the world?
So let me start with the first point that you said, life at sea. Everybody is having this rosy picture, you know, life at sea is like going to a new place every day and seeing the world and a lot of money. That's okay, but that's not fully correct, you know. So things are a bit different when you're out at sea. It's not a bit different, it's very different actually from what it is shown. So as you said, like if sailors decide to stop and go on a strike or something, I think the world will stop, pretty much stop, yeah. So about 90%, or you can say 80% of the trade is majorly carried through shipping routes. And so what happens is, obviously we have a lot of oceans, a lot of water, so transportation on water is much more cheaper, and you can carry a lot more through waterways than you can through any other mode of transport, right? So, and the connectivity between countries, continents becomes easier. So basically, if, like you saw an example of Ever Given, the ship which was stuck at Suez Canal, you know. So one ship caused a backlog of like 5 days or maybe a week, and I think it just got released from custody day before yesterday. So that's what happens, you know. These trade routes are so important. So even if one ship like accidentally is stuck somewhere, or you know, something goes wrong, there's a lot of backlog and everything is affected. You know, you heard the news, like this price will go up, oil prices will go up, you know. There was a ship which had livestock in it. They got stuck. Food was limited. So, yeah, a lot of things can happen. If the sailors are, you know, if they go on strike. So I'm not saying like it's the most important profession or anything, but yeah, it is like a backbone, you can say. I can very, very proudly say that yes, it is a backbone of trade, at least trade, yeah.
I mean, that's truly an insightful opening, right? But then you spoke about how important the shipping routes are, right? And then it not being a rosy picture, right, in terms of what it has shown in movies. But I wanted to kind of take you back to that point where it all began, right? Because in that time when you were born and when we are all of the same age group, right? A lot of it was in terms of when you got to grow up, you have to do engineering or you have to be a doctor or you have to be a lawyer, right? How did it kind of strike you saying, hey, look, I don't want to go with what the general or the common mindset is, right? And then I want to do something different, right? And how did it all begin? Like, what was your story?
So I think it started in 7th or 8th standard. One of my uncles, he is a surveyor at Mumbai Port. So he used to go on these ships to survey the equipment, survey the cargo. And so he used to come back and like narrate stories sometimes, you know. So that's where the idea was planted. Okay, there's this thing called shipping also. Like earlier, everybody wants to be an astronaut and all that when they're, you know, 1, 2, 3 years old. Everybody wants astronaut. Somebody wants this, that and all. Sometime I wanted to be a wrestler also. But yeah, because I used to watch a lot of wrestling. So, but then yeah, 7th, 8th, I think, yeah, the seed got planted. And it just never changed after that. I mean, and then he used to always narrate these stories, you know, where you know, there's a lot of money involved, and yeah, so that kind of fascinated me. Although, yeah, then I pursued it further. There was a seminar at college where one of the institutes had come to give a seminar. So they even like, you know, put up these like PowerPoint presentation where everything was all good. You know, you study 1 year in India, then you go 1 year to Scotland and study, and then you get 1 year internship on the ship. And of course, they showed us how much is the salary and what you can do, what is the future, all that, you know, what they present to you when they want to sell you something. So, yeah. So anyways, after that, I decided like I'll just do this and pretty much followed it.
You were sold basically to what they
presented. I got sold. And then after that, we didn't have a clue as to where I need to go to join, because like at that time, the fees for that particular institute, and this I'm talking about in 2008. So fees were pretty high. It was almost like 5 to 6 lakhs for a 1 year course in India. So I was like thinking, is this genuine or not? So I was in two minds as to what to do. So we had to find other ways. That's how we ended up searching for different colleges and getting more information, talking to other people.
When you went to college, like when you did the 1 year course, right, what did you kind of study initially to join? Like, what are the subjects and what was the training?
I didn't do the 1 year course. So there are two ways to join, you know. There is a 3 year degree course and a 1 year diploma course. So in a 3 year degree course, it's basically like a normal engineering college where you 2-3 years at campus and then 1 year internship on the ship. Whereas in your 1 year diploma course, it's you do 1 year in college and then you do 3 years out at sea. So it's like 36 months out at sea or 18 months out at sea. That is your training period basically. That's where you're at your junior most rank, like cadets basically. So in my training, I had 3 years. So first year was totally like the normal engineering subjects, everything like physics and your geometrical drawing, engineering drawing, all that, chemistry and I don't know what all, mechanical engineering, all that shit. So it was all pretty standard, and then you go on to your professional subjects like, you know, cargo work, navigation, stability, metrology, and all these drawings. All that happens starting from the second year, and then third year they just like, it's like more of a grooming to get out at sea. So they teach you tying of knots and rope work, and you know, simulator based. Radar simulators, there is other simulators, you know, all those things. So yeah,
so till the end of your 3 years you generally don't get onto the boat, is it? Like, it's all
no, it's 3 years fully college, and then the final year is internship. So that is 1 year on the ship. 12 months you need sea time, they call it. So yeah.
But that anticipation is too much, no? Like, 3 years you have to just wait to get to the ship.
Yeah, I think it pretty much prepares you here. Because joining ship is like a different experience altogether. Like, college is still college, right? You're hanging out. There's no seriousness. You know, you're not bothered about what... You have friends all around. If worse comes to worse, you can still leave and go home. You can't do that out at sea, right? If you're bored or you like just feel like quitting, and you just like, you're mentally so drained, you want to go home, you can't. You have to still stay there till you get to the next port. So
crazy. Yeah. So I mean, you actually kind of left the bridge in terms of what was something that was running in my mind, right? Is straight out of the college, when you talked about the 12-month internship, or when you immediately joined the ship, right? You obviously went with a certain perspective thinking, are yaar, like ship, yes, let me enjoy and all of that stuff. But how was your day one and your month one, and how did it go, right? And how was those myths busted in terms of when you joined?
So straight out of college, everybody's excited, you know, to earn some money and all. And that time when you're like, you're just out of college, you're blessed with a stipend of say $700. And back then dollar was like 37 or 40, so 28,000, 30,000, 32,000 every month, big money here. Like, people who join internship and all, I don't think they get a stipend of not more than maybe 5, 6, 7, maximum 10. So 28, 32 every month was like big money. Of course, that's what we joined and we signed up for. So yeah. That was that part of it, but the emotions were quite mixed, you know, leaving home for like 1 year straight, and don't know anybody out there. It will be a totally different crew, totally different working environment. Your theoretical knowledge is just there in your head, you know. It's ultimately what you practice, like what you have. It's more of a hands-on job, so you have to learn everything as you go. And with the experience, that teaches you more and more. So first, yeah, leaving home was the hardest part. Like, of course, homesickness, you know. And then once you get there, it's like anxiety, because you don't know what's coming next. So I used to think that shippies used to work 24 hours, you know, no sleep, nothing. And of course, I was blessed with a good chief officer. So chief officer is a kind of your mentor, you know. You're under him, under his supervision, always. So everything you do, you have to report to him, and, you know, above him is the captain. So, of course, the captain was known to be one of the most dangerous guys in the company that time. He was like a sacking master. So if he's not happy, you go home straight away, no questions asked and all that. The company also does not question him. So I used to... Yeah, life boat, yes. So, yeah, so I was pretty scared of that. And I had taken handover from the previous cadet, and he was like, I got really screwed, man. Full rugged out, 18 hours, 19 hours, and all that shit. So I was like, okay, man, I don't know how I'm going to survive. Just let's go for it. First day, I think I went, I had to, like, there's this thing called soundings where you measure the quantity of water in the tanks. So there were like 18 or 22 tanks, like huge tanks. And then you have these waste tanks called bilges. So I had to take soundings. So you have to go to, there is the accommodation, there is engine room, and you have to go to the under deck passage. That's where all the tanks and their sounding things are located. And I got lost there for like good 4-5 hours. I was inside only. I didn't know the way to come out. I didn't have a watch. I went there around at 8:30. I came out in the afternoon at 3 o'clock or something. And this guy, this chief officer, was like, he was so tensed, you know, because that was my first day. And if something would happen, then it all comes down on his shoulders. So the following evening, he gave me a good bamboo, you know. He's like, where is your watch and what do you think this is? And I was like, sir, I don't know what this is. Like, you didn't come out for tea break. You didn't come out for lunch break. I was like, I didn't know the way out. How the hell do I come out, man? So yeah, I was like totally lost that day.
Is it like a whole maze of machines and all down there?
Yeah, down there is pretty confusing for the first time if you do join. Even now, even if I go on a new ship, I don't know the routes and all. Once I get down, it'll take me a couple of hours or maybe 3 hours, 4 hours to figure out the way up because it's quite confusing.
So you need to have a map or something, is it? Generally?
No. That we use for the sea routes only, not for the ship, bro. So yeah, it's not a map as such, but you have these plans posted everywhere where you can pretty much, you know, now that I can read those plans, earlier I couldn't read. So now that I can read those plans, I know what it is. So yeah, I can find my way out faster. But although it is still new because every ship is a different construction, you know. Some may have a door which has an opening here. The other may have a door behind a door. Or the other may have a stairway. So it's all different. It's not uniformly made, as to say, you know. So that's why it gets confusing. So these new boys who always come, they always get confused. Although we tried to guide them and, you know, tried to familiarize them during the first day itself. So that they don't get lost and all. But sometimes it happens.
But how was your first sail? So you got confused and all, and then you started just sailing. So how was your first experience?
First experience was, I felt seasick for at least 3-4 days, you know, because you're not used to that movement. It's quite different. And then I think I joined somewhere in Hong Kong or Singapore. And we were sailing to China side. So it was like 1 week or something like that. So that time I was still getting used to, you know, the seasickness was still there. I thought I'll go to China and get my shore leave. I'll get to go out. But nothing like that happened. I was made to work extra. Because as a cadet, you don't have the liberty of going out every time, you know. So if your senior thinks you are worthy of it, you have earned it, only then you get to go out. So initially, I think for a good 6 months, I didn't go out of the 9 months. And although I was thinking like I'll get to go in every port and all. So one fine day after 6 months, I was like very fed up. And then before the captain even declared the show leave, I was already in the agent's car saying that I'm going out. I took my bag, I put the cap and all that, everything. I went out with the crew. And after that, I got bambooed again. So yeah, also like I think within the first week I wanted to go to there's this recreation room where everybody sits and watch TV or play some games and all. So I think first 2-3 days these young engineers and all, so they're like, come on, let's go, we'll watch TV and all. So I think the 3rd-4th day I went and my chief officer caught me. He's like, where the hell are you? What are you doing in the recreation room? You're not supposed to go there. Not until like 4 months at least. It's like, okay. So that also stopped. So after, it was like work, cabin. In the cabin, you have to study, do your assignments and all that. And that's it. Sleep. No getting out for recreation purposes.
And the cabin also was, I mean, the space and all was like very different, right?
Very new, yeah. It's just one room, right? It's just one room. So you have a bed, you have a cupboard, a wardrobe, a study table, and a washroom. That's it. So
how is it during like a turbulence and all that in the sea when you're there, you know, like, and you're sleeping in your room, say, and there is a storm or something?
Yeah, so we get to know about these terms quite in advance. Now it depends on the competency of the senior guys, how well they navigate it. Like as a, if you're a cadet and all, you don't have to do anything. Pretty much everything is done by the captain. So he takes a call. So sometimes you do get close to the storms and all. It's quite turbulent that time. We've experienced like 20, 25, 30 degrees of, you know, rolling, like you're moving like this. So everything in your cabin is like, you're not able to sleep, you know, you're like, you become a zombie, all your clothes and all will be just like penduluming, if you can say. Things fall off. Yeah, it's bad during those days. So you do get those times.
Yeah, I mean, that would have been scary, I can imagine. Like, I think sleeping normally only itself in our room is like, I mean, it's a pain to get, I mean, get sleep, right? At such situations, I think you get used to it, right? Yeah, after a while.
Sometimes you don't get sleep at all. So it's like, it's that bad, you know? Because something or the other keeps falling, you know? Like, or, you know, something is kept in your drawer and it'll, because of the movement, it'll, that keeps happening and it keeps bugging you, right? So,
yeah,
that's irritating.
Yeah, but yeah, I mean, crazy. I mean, I'm just trying to think, what if I was there, right, in the ship, and I was thinking how I would have kind of handled all of this stuff, right? But then, like you mentioned, right, a very few carriers help you, at, or maybe very few carriers actually really have the sense of you traveling across the world, right? The length and breadth of the world. And this career that you're part of, this industry that you're part of, is one of the very few of those careers, right? How has your experience been? I mean, obviously you told that, okay, when you're a cadet, you can't really do stuff. Not really much, right? But then once you started traveling the world, how was it? And what were your experiences traveling the world?
So, yeah, as you rightly said, you know, not all careers give you this option of travel and getting paid at the same time. But for us, it's like it's our job, you know. So we have to take it in a different way. You can't come here on a vacation. You're not on a vacation. Like, although it may seem like it's that is my job and my vacation is here at home. So, you know, that mindset has to be different. Of course, you can't go out in all the countries, as although we want to, and you can't be out 24 hours because there's a lot happening on the ship itself. There's cargo, there's refueling, there's provisions, you know. So all these things happen while you're at port. So you're in port for a good maybe 12 hours or on like the ships that I work on, it's container ships. And so I've done container ships and car carriers. The port stay, it is itself like 6 hours, maximum 12 hours, you know, not more than that. So if you go to a slow working port, it can be around one day. So we work in shifts. So you got like 6 hour shifts. So as an officer, you have to inspect the cargo. You have to keep a watch on all that's going on, you know. So then there is, you get fuels, you get supplies, food supplies, you get machinery supplies. There's some servicing or repairing going on. Something or the other keeps happening. So you can't like go out 24 hours and, you know, see everything. So whatever time, little time we get, the off time, 6 hours. So we try to manage, you know, find out some places which are close by, go out, go to malls, do some shopping, get some chocolates and all that. So yeah, that's how we balance it. So it's not all, so as I was saying, the rosy picture part of it, it's not that rosy, you know. You can't like, if you go out to say Australia, you can't just spend one day in Sydney, in the harbor, and you know, come back like nothing's happened. No, it's not possible. And then after that, you have to come back and work again. So you need to be prepared for that. So you have to balance it out, your rest hours and your work hours.
What is your shortest stay in a country?
Shortest stay, I think, 3 hours. 3 hours. 3 hours, I think we went to discharge one car in Africa, in one port. So the route to that car, route to that port was almost 2 hours. We had to get in there. The authorities and everybody else took us 2 hours to clear, and then 1 hour for discharging one car, and then back. So yeah,
But how expensive must the shipping be itself be, right? Just for one.
I think they must be making quite a lot of profit to, you know, do this. So they are, yeah. So otherwise they wouldn't agree, right?
But then, Jeff, just a question that came to me, right? What happens when you, I mean, when you dock on a port, or maybe the whole process, what happens when you're kind of nearing a port to that point when you leave back? I mean, when you kind of go out of that port, what all happens in middle of that?
Okay, so let me ride you through like what happens. So sailing time is sailing, no problem. Then there is a point where, you know, there's only a point till which you can take the ship yourself. So the master is the head of the ship, the captain. We can only be to that point. We can't go beyond, because then you start the port limits, the country's jurisdiction, you know, all that legal aspects. So that point is like, you call that as a pilot point. So you have to sail to that point, and then a local pilot, a local guide, basically, he boards the ship. He will help you dock. And then your cargo operations will start. If you have any stores or provisions, you will receive those things. If you have any bunkering like fuels, refueling or anything, you got those things coming on. You have barges which come. If you have to remove garbage from the ship, so there's another barge that will come to take out the garbage. Then you have any surveys or inspections or anything of that sort. So inspectors will come. Then sometimes people come to check the cargo, so they will come. Your authorities, immigration, port police, security, and immigration officers, your agents, all they will be boarding the ship, and you know. So by the time they give all your clearance, you're almost 2-3 hours already in port, and then it depends on how much cargo you have, how much you have to load, how much you have to discharge, how long. Then it depends on the port working speed, you know. So all that is done. And then after that, the paperwork, after the cargo work is also there. So you have to sign a lot of documents, you call them bills of lading. So once you've loaded the cargo, you need to sign papers, authorize, stamp everything. So after that only you can sail out. After all the documentation, basically. So it's a lot of documentation, actually. We send out now it's electronic format, and physical paperwork is quite less, but otherwise there is this much of documents that go out, you know, the copies for, one is for medical, one is for quarantine officers, one is for some immigration officer, health authorities and this and that. So there's a lot of paperwork that is involved.
Clearly not vacationing.
Absolutely not, bro. Yeah. So there you are on 24 hours, you know, you're on call 24 hours. So even if it's not like, if it's your rest hours and you're needed at that point of time, you have to go. You cannot say, no, I'm sleeping, I cannot join now, this, that, nothing. You have to go. So that's one thing, you know, and be it Saturday, Sunday, it's doesn't matter. That's it.
Yeah. And an important thing is you don't have the country's passport. You have a different passport, right?
Yeah. So so as a seafarer, you don't need visa for each country, you know. Once you're joined, your paperwork does everything. So if you want to go out also, you just need the permission of the local authorities. That's it. Then you have an ID card and you can go out. Yeah.
With the seaman's passport.
It's not a seaman's passport. The passport is different. This is a continuous discharge certificate. It's called CDC. Yeah. So we need to have that if you're sailing. CDC, that's important.
What is one crazy experience that you had when you were out in any country, right?
So I think on this car carrier, we did Africa run, West Africa. And I think we did 10 ports in 1.5 week. So I think almost every day there was a port, every other day there was. So we were doing West Africa, right from South Africa going to there's this place called Nouakchott, Mauritanian, by the way, Mauritania. I think that comes at Nouakchott, that That's the final port. So we did 10 ports in the middle. That was a crazy experience because Africa, as you know, is a highly dangerous country. So we heard a lot of stories, and also en route Africa, there's a lot of risk, you know, piracy and all this robberies and all that keep happening. So we were scared for that. Then once you get to Africa, it's not easy because they are like, they still need like this much bundle of paperwork from you. They want a declaration of literally everything that you have. Even as a crew member, you need to declare your currency, how many coins you have, how many notes you have, the different value of the currency that you have, everything that's in your room, right from, you know, your gold chain or a ring or personal effects, your Bluetooth speaker, hard disk, everything. They need to know everything that's there. And if they come for inspection and you have not declared it, that's not yours anymore. That just goes into their pockets.
So have you faced any like pirate situation in the ship?